Ladies and gentlemen, the ceremony is about to begin. Please take your seats and silence any electronic devices. Ladies and gentlemen, Alan Holt, Vice Chairman of the United States Holocaust Memorial Council.
Good morning, Speaker McCarthy, other members of Congress, members of the administration, members of the diplomatic corps, distinguished guests, and our most cherished survivors, welcome to our nation's commemoration of the victims of the Holocaust. As everyone knows, World War II involved two wars, a military one and a Nazi Germany genocidal war against the Jews, as well as other racial and political so-called enemies, such as Roma and Sinti, Slavs, people with disabilities, and gay men. These wars claimed an average of 27,600 lives every day, or one death every 3 seconds. In addition to this extraordinary loss of life, the future of freedom was at stake. Something worth remembering in the hallowed halls of this temple of democracy. That is why every year we begin this ceremony with a tribute to the American soldiers who fought to defeat Nazism and liberated the concentration camps 78 years ago this month. Those soldiers had become hardened by battle, yet nothing prepared them for what they would witness. Humans had engaged in war since the beginning of time, but continent-wide genocide from a modern state, this was new. A threshold had been crossed. Those young soldiers knew it, and their leader, General Dwight Eisenhower, whose statue so appropriately stands in the rotunda of this sacred building, most certainly knew it. He took time from the war effort to visit a camp to see if the reports he had read could possibly be true. When he entered Ohrdruf, a subcamp of Buchenwald, he realized that they did not even begin to describe what human beings had done to other human beings. Eisenhower immediately ordered other Allied soldiers to witness the camps. But he did much more. Worried that people would not believe the truth, he urged journalists and members of Congress to visit the camps and to be witnesses. He hoped that an abundance of firsthand accounts of the atrocities would prevent anyone from ever disbelieving them or attributing them to propaganda. Sadly, he was wrong, very wrong. Today, we witness that very charge of propaganda from those who would deny or minimize the Holocaust. This amidst rising antisemitism and racism. Those soldiers who fought for our freedom would be shocked to see our world. Those soldiers who liberated some of the few surviving Jews, including my own parents, would never be forgotten. So today, as we honor them, we recognize they played many roles. They also cared for survivors, resettled displaced persons, and supported the pursuit of justice. And they played one more role of enormous significance. They were witnesses. Delbert Cooper, with the 71st Infantry Division, wrote this in a letter to his wife, and I quote, "I never want to see a sight again as we saw when we pulled in there. 1,400 starving, diseased, stinking people. Some had been in camps for as long as 8 years. So help me, I cannot see how they stood it. No longer were most of them people. They were nothing but things that were once human beings. Please do me a favor and type up this complete letter for me. Want to show it to people when I come home. As the first eyewitnesses to the Holocaust, the liberating soldiers were given a huge responsibility. Winning the war was not enough. Having seen the true potential of human depravity, having learned the unthinkable was possible, they now had the burden of communicating this knowledge to the world. They shared this responsibility with the survivors, with whom they forged an unshakable bond. We owe so much to the liberators, our freedom, peace, and prosperity. We also owe them profound gratitude for promoting understanding and protecting truth. Their courage and then their witness was where the cause of Holocaust remembrance began. Today, that cause must be ours.
Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the presentation of the flags of the United States Army Liberating Divisions. First Infantry Division, Falkenau under Eger. 101st Airborne Division, Lotsberg. 2nd Infantry Division, Leipzig, Schönefeld, and Spergau. 82nd Airborne Division, Wirbeling. 4th Infantry Division, Dachau Subcamps. 20th Armored Division, Dachau. 8th Infantry Division, Wirbeling. 14th Armored Division, Dachau Subcamps. 26th Infantry Division, Gusen. 12th Armored Division, Landsberg. 29th Infantry Division, Dinslagen. 11th Armored Division, Gusen and Mauthausen. 30th Infantry Division, Waferlingen. 10th Armored Division, Landsberg. 36th Infantry Division, Kaufering Camps. 9th Armored Division, Falkenau under Eger. 42nd Infantry Division, Dachau. 8th Armored Division, Halberstadt, Zwieberge. 45th Infantry Division, Dachau. 6th Armored Division, Buchenwald. 63rd Infantry Division, Kaufering Camps. 4th Armored Division, Ordruf. 65th Infantry Division, Flossenburg Subcamp. 3rd Armored Division, Dora Mittelbau. 69th Infantry Division, Leipzig Tekla. 104th Infantry Division, Dora Mittelbau. 71st Infantry Division, Gunskirchen. 103rd Infantry Division, Landsberg. 80th Infantry Division, Buchenwald and Ebensee. 99th Infantry Division, Dachau Subcamps. 83rd Infantry Division, Langenstein. 95th Infantry Division, Werl. 84th Infantry Division, Alam and Salzwedel, 90th Infantry Division, Flossenburg. 86th Infantry Division, Attendorn. 89th Infantry Division, Ordrup. 'Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the presentation of the national colors and the national anthem. Be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, Ambassador Stuart Eisenstadt, Chairman of the United States Holocaust Memorial Council.
Speaker McCarthy, members of Congress, survivors, we're deeply moved every year at this ceremony by the processional of the survivors and then of the liberating division flags. If not for those brave soldiers and our allies, the survivors would not be with us to bear witness and serve as our most important teachers. As Elie Wiesel said, the survivors' willingness to share their knowledge, their pain, their anguish, even their agony, is motivated solely by their conviction that their survival was for a purpose. A survivor sees himself or herself as a messenger and a guardian of the secrets of the dead. A survivor fears he or she may be the last to remember, the last to warn, the last to tell the tale that must be told in its totality before it is too late. That is what brings us together year after year. Today we gather nearly 8 decades after the end of the war, 8 decades during which the survivors built their lives and families, made innumerable contributions to the United States and the world, and fulfilled Elie Wiesel's aspiration by building a global movement to ensure that their memories would be a force for good, a warning against evil in the world, and a lesson and an inspiration to the future. But we must also remember that it's been 8 decades in which the world was expected to live up to its post-war declaration of never again to antisemitism, to racism, to hatred of those who are different, and to genocide. Clearly, this is not our world today. So we need the message of the survivors more than ever. The United States Holocaust Memorial Museum was created for this purpose. I recommended its creation to President Carter, to honor the memory of the victims, to preserve and amplify the voices of the survivors, to educate the world about the horrific tragedy that befell them, and to remind people around the globe of this essential lesson. The Holocaust was not inevitable. It was preventable. It was preventable because there were numerous warning signs that went unheeded by leaders and citizens in the United States and Europe, just as there are warning signs in all genocides and crimes against humanity since the Holocaust. Hitler methodically proceeded step by step, gauging German and world opinion to see how far he could go on his murderous path. And what he saw was no country boycotted the 1936 Olympic Games. The nations attending the 1938 Avignon Conference, called by President Roosevelt to deal with the growing problem of German Jewish refugees, refused to open their doors and lift their immigration quotas. The German ship St. Louis, with 937 Jewish refugees, was refused entry into Miami Harbor in 1939. And no economic sanctions were imposed against Nazi Germany until Hitler declared war on the United States 4 days after Pearl Harbor. We often ask ourselves, what made the Holocaust possible? One part of the answer is indifference, the failure to heed these warning signs, and the utter silence of Germans as their neighbors were deported, their possessions stolen, their synagogues ransacked, and yes, the silence of the entire world. Another part of the answer is the widespread antisemitism that permeated Europe for centuries, long before the Nazis came to power. Heeding these lessons is urgently needed in our time, as the Holocaust is receding in memory, and the survivor generation is diminishing. And we face Holocaust ignorance, denial, distortion, and manipulation, spread like a virus through social media. Vladimir Putin distorts and trivializes World War II and the Holocaust to justify his outrageous invasion of Ukraine. And now, in our own country, the unthinkable, anti-Semitic attacks on Jews and synagogues are increasingly happening, and influential Americans are increasingly invoking conspiracy theories about Jews that are frighteningly reminiscent of the anti-Semitism that made the Holocaust possible. This is why the global memory movement that the survivors have built is more important than ever. It is their legacy and their challenge to us. And that's also why our keynote speaker is uniquely suited for this moment. For decades, Professor Ambassador Deborah Lipstadt, a longtime personal friend and colleague, has been researching, writing, and teaching about all these issues with great prescience. As long ago as 1986, she wrote an important book revealing how extensive knowledge of the Holocaust was as it was unfolding before the world's eyes. With the fitting title, Beyond Belief, the American Press and the Coming of the Holocaust. For the lesson of the survivors and the lesson of Supreme Allied Commander Dwight Eisenhower, as my colleague Alan Holt said when he saw Wardruff, is you must believe. Her next book took this theme even further and anticipated our world today. She wrote Denying the Holocaust, the Growing Assault on Truth and Memory, which led to her historic trial with a Holocaust denier, David Irving. Later, recognizing the rise of various forms of anti-Semitism, she addressed this topic head-on in a book aptly titled Anti-Semitism Here and Now. And now, here and now is precisely what brings us here together. Because as the survivors have taught us, and as Ambassador Lipstadt's entire career demonstrates, the lessons of the Holocaust are not only timeless, they are timely. All this made her ideally suited to assume the role of United States Special Envoy to monitor and combat anti-Semitism in the State Department, my colleague there, as well as I'm special advisor to Secretary Blinken on the Holocaust. It's my great honor to introduce noted scholar, noted author, special friend of the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum, Ambassador Deborah Lipstadt.
Thank you, Ambassador Eisenstadt, my good friend Stuart, fellow Atlantan, for that gracious introduction. And thank you for all you have done for slave laborers, Holocaust survivors, and for the commemoration of the memory of the Holocaust. Years ago, you helped make the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum a reality. Today, you help it continue to flourish and educate. Your contribution is unsurpassed. I am honored beyond measure to have been invited to give this address. The Capitol is America's public square, and the fact that in 1979, President Jimmy Carter signed a resolution originated by Senator John Danforth and passed unanimously by both houses of this Congress, determining that the United States shall mark this day of remembrance in this America's most sacred space, speaks volumes about how our country confronts both the challenges of the past and of the moment. As Sarah Bloomfield, the director of this august institution, likes to remind me, I occupy a unique position in the annals of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. I served as a consultant over on 2000 L Street, helping to design the permanent exhibition when the site of the museum occupies today, was a big hole in the ground. I subsequently was honored to receive two presidential appointments to the United States Holocaust Memorial Council and chaired three different committees. After completing my terms, I was honored to receive two different fellowships to the Center for Advanced Holocaust Studies, where I wrote two books. I am, I believe, the only person who has been a consultant, a member of the executive committee, and a recipient of the museum's largesse. Not surprisingly, I feel an immense debt of gratitude to it. And now, I have been entrusted by the President of the United States to monitor and combat what has been called, and rightfully so, one of the oldest or longest hatreds. It was this hatred, of course, which was the foundation stone of what we have come to call the Holocaust. In the past year, I've traveled widely and met with numerous people, Americans and foreigners, in that effort. While the job I do after just a year in office still seems new to me, the fight is age old. Already in the 8th century, the text of the Passover Haggadah, the text setting forth the order of the Passover Seder, included a line that many of us here recited just a few weeks ago, "Bechol dor omdim aleinu lechaloteinu." In every generation, there are those who rise up to destroy us. Clearly, even in the 8th century, if not earlier, the authors of the Haggadah understood that anti-Semitism, or Jew hatred, to put it more simply, was a stunningly persistent phenomenon. Its ability to adapt over millennia to different political, religious, and social settings was remarkable then and remained so over 1,200 years later. One might assume that given the age-old nature of this animus, the world at large would be able to easily identify anti-Semitism. Long before I entered this position, I was already struck by the fact that so many well-meaning people, Jews and non-Jews, had trouble recognizing it. Now, that's not a reflective of a shortcoming on their part. It's because anti-Semitism can be sometimes hard to identify. Let me explain. Anti-Semitism has distinguishing characteristics that make it unique or different from other prejudices. Primary among them, as we heard just a moment ago, it is a conspiracy theory. The anti-Semite posits that the purportedly all-powerful Jew stealthily conspires to use their ill-gotten financial might, political strength, and inordinate influence to benefit themselves at the expense of non-Jews. The anti-Semite believes that Jews conspire to control the media, the banks, courts, political leaders, and even pandemics. If there is something they do not like in society, the anti-Semite finds it in the Jew. Secondly, anti-Semitism is ubiquitous, coming from every place on the political, national, and religious spectrum, from Christians, from Muslims, from atheists, and even from Jews. It flourishes in places where there are Jews and where there are no Jews. Yet even as the conspiracy theory morphs over time and amongst different groups with varying political outlooks, the underlying perception of the devious, all-controlling, conspiring, cosmopolitan Jew remains remarkably the same. Thirdly, many people find anti-Semitism hard to identify because their perception of what a victim of prejudice does not include the Jew. As a means of dealing with this and other ambiguities regarding the nature of this hatred, Secretary Blinken has, and I quote, "enthusiastically embraced," end quote, the non-legally binding working International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance definition of anti-Semitism. I'm often asked what my goal is for my tenure in office. While I certainly hope to be able to reduce the proliferation of the expressions of anti-Semitism, I also hope to enhance the world's understanding that the fight against anti-Semitism is not a niche issue. It's about far more than protecting Jews, although if it were just that, it would be sufficient, for it is a fundamental obligation of a government to keep its citizens safe, especially the most vulnerable among them. But anti-Semitism is much more than an attack on Jews. It is an attack on democracy. The anti-Semite believes that Jews have an all-controlling power over every aspect of government and society. The anti-Semite believes democracy is a sham. In any country where anti-Semitism is left free to range, democracy is at stake. Freedom is at risk, security is at risk, stability is at risk. The doubts the National Socialists, the Nazis, sowed about Weimar democracy and the way it was a nefarious conspiracy of the Jews helped bring it down and slowly led to the ultimate horror of the Holocaust. That is why President Biden, Vice President Harris, Secretary Blinken, and governors and lawmakers from both sides of the aisle rightfully consider anti-Semitism not just a threat to a particular group of Americans, but also a threat to democracy and international security. Anti-Semites cling to their conspiratorial fantasies, even though in the last century, but 80 years ago, Nazi Germany, with its allies, managed to murder a third of world Jewry while the world stood by. Had the Jews been the all-powerful group that the anti-Semites believed them to be, would they have allowed that to be done? And of course, what may start with the Jews never ends there. The horrific ideas which produced the Holocaust engulf persons with the disabilities, Roma, Sinti, gay men, Slavs, and so many others. And in the decades since, we have seen the same flames of hatred ignite into ethnic cleansing, mass murder, and genocide. Sadly, never again has really become again and again. For decades, Americans could treat anti-Semitism as a problem for other countries to resolve. Here, we consider it more theoretical than tangible, but that is no longer the case. Today, we are witnessing a rise in anti-Semitism worldwide, the United States included. In fact, the issue has become so urgent that President Biden in December ordered federal departments and agencies to come together to develop the first national strategy to counter this vicious hatred. Numerous other countries and the European Union have done the same. Anti-Semitism is, but it's not something just to be studied and analyzed. Its effects are felt daily, up close and personal in a very humane way, human way. It impacts Jews' regular routines and lives. There's hardly a Jewish institution in Europe or the United States or other parts of the world that doesn't have some form of security at its door. At my synagogue, police officers and congregants patrol the grounds. If they don't recognize you as a regular, they question you. It's decidedly different from many other houses of worship, where the doors are open to welcome all who wish to enter. Many students, Jewish students, pick colleges based on how safe it is to openly identify as a Jew. Some think twice about putting a mezuzah containing the verses of the Torah on their door. Parents who used to allow their young teens to walk to school on their own now hesitate to synagogue on their own, now hesitate to do so. Some are reluctant to send their children to Jewish schools. Some counsel their children to tuck their Jewish stars under their shirts. Ball caps are often employed to cover kippot or skull caps. Parents of middle school and high school students worry as they see their children's classmates openly express anti-Semitism, even as the school administration dithers about what to do. This is too often the contemporary Jewish reality in America and in many other countries. It is notable that this reality of Jew hatred, whether here or in America or in other places, has not defeated the Jewish people. The line from the Haggadah, which I quoted a moment ago, "B'chol dor omdim aleinu l'chaloteinu," in every generation there are those who rise up to destroy us, is followed by a far more positive affirmation, "V'hakadosh baruch hu matzileinu miyadam," and God rescues us from their hands. Believers may see this as an expression of divine intervention. Others may see it as an expression of age-old Jewish resiliency, and yet others see it as both. It is what Jews have long called mazel. But divine intervention and Jewish resiliency are not enough. We all have a role to play. People of all nationalities and identities and faiths often ask me, what can I do? This I can answer, speak out. Speaking out may not eradicate anti-Semitism, but it can contain it. When you hear something, say something, whether it's at the office, the market, the gym, or the airport. If the person making the remark in ignorance is saying it in ignorance, point out its fallacies. If it's being said maliciously, make it clear that such language is unacceptable. If the person saying it is from your group and shares your other ideas, speak out even more forcefully. Saying nothing emboldens the anti-Semite and normalizes prejudice. We often keep silent, and I hear this from my students, because we don't want to wish to make a fuss. But that option is no longer viable. We may make colleagues, friends, fellow shoppers, roommates, or guests uncomfortable. We may lose a friend, but as I tell my students, do we really want to be friends with someone who harbors such beliefs? The president, his administration, and the members of Congress are calling out anti-Semitism and acting to counter it. We must join them. You must join us in this fight. Speaking out may be costly, but keeping silent is far costlier. I close with the note of cautious and relative optimism, something that is rare when we speak of Jew hatred. In the face of the increasing normalization of anti-Semitism, we often hear people asking, is this the same as the 1930s? Are we on the edge of a historical and tragic redux? I can answer with a resounding no. Today is radically different. In the 1930s and 40s, the persecution was emanating from governments. Governments were expelling, persecuting, and eventually murdering Jews. Today, it is quite different. I stand before you as someone who was presidentially nominated, Senate-confirmed, special envoy, whose mandate is to combat this vile form of hate. I hold the position that this Congress, some members here, elevated to the ambassadorial level. From both sides of the Capitol and both sides of the aisle, we hear as recently as last week bipartisan calls for ensuring that my office has the full support necessary to fight this fight. Moreover, I am not alone. Other countries have appointed people to similar positions focused on anti-Semitism and Holocaust issues. Imagine if there had been a special envoy to monitor and combat anti-Semitism in the United States State Department or other foreign offices in the world. In 1938, after Kristallnacht, when Jews were desperate to find a haven, or in 1939, as was mentioned earlier, when the SS St. Louis and other ships which carried refugees were turned away, or in 1942, when deportations were at their height and trains were rolling across Europe, bringing Jews to their death, or in the spring of 1944, when Nazi defeat was a sure thing, yet the Germans, with the help of the Hungarian Axis regime, deported 500,000 Hungarian Jews and murdered most of them. Or in the fall of 1944, when the existence of gas chambers in Auschwitz and Birkenau was confirmed, and so many people implored our government to bomb them and stop the killings. Just imagine. In addition to the President, Vice President, Secretary of State, and members of the United States Congress, fully supporting the work of my office and that of the Special Envoy for Holocaust Issues, today we have, thanks again to that bipartisan support of this government, a United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. This living memorial educates and inspires both the public at large and professionals from every segment of society, law enforcement, judiciary, military, diplomacy, medicine, education, and religion, to gain fresh insights into their responsibilities today. We do this so that as President Carter and Senator Danforth, together with so many others wished, we can finally stop the past from being repeated. It is this support that allows me, in the words of the Book of Devarim, Deuteronomy, to be strong and of good courage. but the full support of the United States government is not sufficient to combat anti-Semitism. Government efforts must go hand in hand with the support of all people of good conscience, by all, including those who hold no official position, but who know that the peace and well-being of the world in which they live is threatened by Jew hatred and hatred of all sorts. What starts with the Jews never stops with the Jews. We see the confluence between anti-Semitism and racism all over the world, and especially in this country. Hate cannot be fought in silos. It starts with one group and it goes to the others. Today, together, let us rise and say, after the genocide of World War II and the many genocides that have followed and continue to follow in its wake, enough is enough. When we see hatred of any kind, we will rise up and speak out with one voice. This cannot stand. This shall not stand. Enough is enough. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are honored to have more than 30 Holocaust survivors with us today. And now some will share memorial reflections.
I'm Susan Warsinger. Some of the survivors here today brought treasured items with them to this remembrance ceremony. However, many survivors have nothing tangible that testifies to what they experienced and lost. Everyone and everything they knew was taken away and destroyed, leaving only memories. I'm one of the lucky ones. I have several documents and photographs from my early life in Germany, including this photo of my great aunt Anna standing behind me and next to my mother pushing my brother Joe's stroller. I think of the wonderful visits to her house where we played in the parlor, chased the chickens in the yard, and had the first tastes of her delicious bulbenik, still hot from the oven. I shall always remember my Tante Anna and my Uncle Heinrich Knoll, both of whom were deported to the Riga ghetto and did not survive. I also remember my great-grandmother, Hulda Katz.
My name is Ruth Ellenberg Eisenberg. This photo is of my brother Yitzhak. I am so grateful to have it, but it is also a painful reminder that I have no photo of my other siblings or my parents whom I never saw. I have my son here with me that's named after my brother Yitzhak. I'm fortunate to have a son, a wonderful son that is accompanying me. He's named after my brother, and his name is Irvin. While escaping from a hiding place in our basement, my father was captured along with two of my sisters and my baby niece. My mother died in the field, too weak to leave the hole in the earth in which we had taken refuge. Later, my brother, unable to find a place, was killed in a bombing. I shall always remember my family members, Hersh, my father, Faga, my mother, Malka, my sister, Miriam, my sister, Yitzchak, this brother, and my little baby niece.
I'm Peter Stein. I have a vivid memory of my grandmother Sophie visiting our apartment in Prague when she was 78 and I was 6. It was June 1942. She brought a chicken liver casserole, my father's favorite snack, and gave me a taste. She and my parents went into the living room to talk, closing the door behind them. When my grandmother returned to the kitchen, she hugged me and whispered, "I love you." A short time later, she was deported to Theresienstadt, where she would die 21 days after arrival. I remember my grandmother, Sophie Marcus Stein.
My name is Joël Nomik. The last time we heard from my father Jean was in a letter he wrote from Bergen-Belsen just after it was liberated, saying we would be reunited soon. He never returned. Just a few weeks ago, through the museum's research, I finally learned that my father never left Bergen-Belsen and likely died from typhus soon after sending that letter. Now, after all these years, for the first time, I can recite the mourner's Kaddish on a date close to the actual one. For millions of victims, there was no date, and even worse, no one would survive to say Kaddish for them at all. As we recite the mourner's Kaddish and chant the traditional prayer for the souls of the dead with cantor Ariane Brown, I invite you to stand and hold high the photo on your chair. Together, we honor their lives and remember them. Yidgadal veit kadash shmei rabba. Bealma divra chihutei. Veyamlich malchutei bechayilikom u yomeikom u chaye dechol beit Israel. Baagala u vizman kariv vimru. Amen. Yesh Shemei Rabba Emvarak Lealam Ulalmei Almaya Yid Barak Veishtabach Veishpar Veit Roman Veit Nase Veit Adar Veit Ale Veit Alal Shmei Kuksha Rihu Leila Minchol Bicharta Veshirata Tushbechata Venechatmata Daamiran Baalma Vimru Amen. יש להשלמה רבה מן שמיה וחיים עלינו ועל כל ישראל ואמרו. אמן. עושה שלום במרומיו, יועשה שלום עלינו ועל כל ישראל ואמרו. אמן. This was the tefillin of my father that I have conserved and I will give my son. Thank you.
Shohen ba mirumim המרצחים הגרמנים ועוזריהם משאר העמים. באושוויץ, טרבלינקה, מיידנק, מאוטהאוזן, ברגן-בלזן, סוביבור, ובשאר מחנות ההשמדה.
Ladies and gentlemen, please be seated.
My name is Atiba D'Souza Jr., and I remember.
My name is Micah Farrell Rogers, and I remember.
My name is Avery Max, and I remember.
My name is Amy Kyoko, and I remember.
My name is Kyrie Smith, and I remember.
My name is Alexander Kirk, and I remember.
Ladies and gentlemen, Sarah Bloomfield, Director of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum.
This is a day of mourning and remembering, but it's also a day of inspiration and hope. Where is their hope, you might ask? From the victims themselves, who, despite being silenced by their killers, continue to speak to us across the ages. The victims give us inspiration and hope because they defied their oppressors in so many ways, by maintaining their dignity, by reaffirming their humanity, by surviving multiple horrors just to see another day, and even by taking up arms against all odds. 1943 was a year of stunning resistance across Europe, in ghettos, in forests, even in killing centers. Exactly 80 years ago yesterday, 700 Jews in the Warsaw Ghetto, many just in their teens and 20s, launched what became the first and largest significant urban revolt against German occupation in Europe. Their meager weapons, most of them homemade, had absolutely no chance against German military might. Yet miraculously, they sustained a guerrilla battle for 27 days. 27 days. The Jews lost militarily, but they won the war for courage, honor, and justice. Their defiance shocked the Germans. Their defiance resonated throughout Europe, and their defiance inspired uprisings in other ghettos. It would also inspire 21-year-old Hirsch Glick, a prisoner in the Vilna ghetto, to write the Hymn of the Partisans before he was murdered. His Yiddish song became the anthem for resistance and partisan fighters across Europe. Every time I hear this song, I always think about how someone in such unimaginably horrific circumstances could summon up such creativity and resolve. And I always think about the song's continued refrain, "We are here, we are here." This is a song of determination, bravery, and hope for the future, even if it would not be their future. It was written for them and for us. Never forget, it was written for us, because they may not be here, but we are.
Please stand for the singing of the Hymn of the Partisans, led by cantor Ariane Brown, and the retirement of the division flags.
Forward, march!
Nit kein mol has to gaste am letzten weg. Hoch himlen blaien verstern bloie tag. Kommen wird noch unser euch gebänkte scho. Es wird der Punkt und unser Brot mir sein in do. Kommen wird noch unser euch gebänkte scho. Es wird der Punkt und unser Brot mir sein in do.
Thank you.
Thank you for sharing our national commitment to Holocaust remembrance. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes our program.